as we introduce our next act, he's gazing at the... he's here. He's come all the way from London, as have the other people who were late. But he wasn't late. Yes, he was, because he had to come early. And he was late for that. He's going to give us a multimedia demonstration of his audio-visual treat, The Imagination Thief. He's looking at me like he's not. He is. How do I introduce him? He's unique, but so is everyone. He's experimental. He's interactive. He was a leading scene of the New York, leading ballet in the New York scene of the 1990s, and lived to tell the tale, unlike many others. He's here today to delight you and intrigue you and entrance you. It's Mr. Rohan Quine.
Here it is then, sound and vision. Space unfurls, ballooning forward, up and out in front of me. 10 giant floodlights rear up skyward from the highest outer rim above the stadium's upper circles. The dizzy fall of bluish-white light across a landscape of several hundred thousand tiny heads below is fierce, and yet it's also feeble, spilling to the ground beneath the cold, gigantic darkness of infinity beyond it. And now, the floods start to dim very slowly. The crowd's random babble dims along with the floods, while a unified cheer fades in from round the stadium. I close my eyes, seated here in my hidden perch above the big screen, and listen. I let my eyelids open and raise my glance. The cheer swells louder and the floods keep on dimming, till for 2 or 3 seconds, just a scratch of blue filament in each of the 10 banks of huge glass bulbs is left against the blackness. Then this dies too, and faint stars appear instead, dotting the entire sky. The cheer simmers down again to quiet and expectancy. My outer gaze descends from the minuscule stars to alight upon the central of the 3 camera lenses ahead of me. The focus of the audience approaches its peak. I slide my outer gaze aside, laying bare my sensors but not projecting anything. Immediately, I feel the hushed attention of every person present as a soft silk string fired out across the stadium and sticking to me, soft and intelligent, the optical fiber of a secret human spider. Behind me, where I'm perched, a dim glow fades up to silhouette me as arranged. The big screen beneath me shows its first image, just my head, full on, but silhouetted black against the glow. In the instance, as the audience observes this and murmurs, I feel an outward pulling of attention on my face from every seat around the stadium, non-physical but potent and growing all the time. A pull from eyelash close to the spanning of a dam across the width of a valley. The moment of optimum audience focus arrives. The surface of the deep blue night is a shiver like a shiny poster rippling in a breeze. Lamps around the cameras burn bright and light me up, so I burst alive and huge upon the giant screen below. A tiny curling spotlight like a hair hits Alaya far beneath me, where she stands on the stage underneath the big screen. I open my projectors, and my eyes on the screen flood the lower echelons of the stadium with ocean, and the music of this ocean fills the watching bodies, buoys them up and carries them, as if the most bewitching tide of melody and harmony were sweeping them in circles. Fluorescent waves lap the shore, the scent of brine suffuses the enormity of space ahead, then over the horizon it appears, the greatest ship you've ever seen. Gliding through the silence behind the ocean's music, it's the size of a range of hills, the shape of an oil tanker, deepest black, its many decks twinkling with strange lights, bewitching on the night sea. Who knew this ship would come? My projectors insinuate the shadow of a question. Do you want this? Yes, my senses catch your answer, huge and immediate. I love your answer, and I love you too, although I know that love is pretty easy at this distance. Yes, of course you want this ship, though I know you didn't ask for it. You're mesmerized there where you sway among the waves before its majesty and magic. So take this ship, it's yours. Its prow rides higher in the sky than the floods as the stadium revolves. Alaya's voice rises through the splashing of the waves to a chorus of voices that pour from the ship's decks as honey into black sea or willow sap weeping into plumb dark depths. Figures can be glimpsed on every level of the vessel, silhouetted on the ballroom glow inside it. Most of these are standing at the railings of the decks, staring out across the water at us huddled in the stadium, while others float behind them down the length of the ship. Some figures must be 3 meters tall, one or two with antlers of some kind. Seahounds leap where the lush foam dances underneath the prow, their yaps like squeaks across the gulf of air and spray. The vessel towers closer, but our viewpoint rises, sweeping up till we're above it, floating in among its aerials and minarets and turrets. Steam wreathes around us, belching up from the funnels. On a tower near below, a mighty searchlight revolves every 15 seconds like a lighthouse, flinging out a path of white a mile across the waves. Ahead, where the sun has set, a band of sky is clear scarlet. As Elia's song wells through my eyes and fills the space of air, bells boom vast somewhere further round the earth's curve. Silent cracks of lightning flicker white through the scarlet, and I feel your adoration through your million spider's silks. Her sound grows in volume, and the audience is silent. Never has a sound like this been heard on earth before, a voice that is thunder and lullaby, channeled from above, beyond, and inside the world, of a beauty that is terrifying, wordless, and sublime. No words could evoke it, for her song's the song that made us and our words, the wail of all destruction and creation made as sound. Monolithic slabs of grey longing, big as mountains, push across the sky. A skeleton of girders equipped with the strength to march around the world and push the world's horizon round the world's curve, but also with a human skin's naked sensitivity. So, now you are attending, I say to every one of you, inspect these golden eyes on screen, and know that you have seen them before in your own mind. Hear what you heard then, but hear it loud and clear, for this screen is even bigger, and the pupils of these golden eyes are even deeper black. To everyone, your own primal scenes flicker up on screen within my eyes, and music plays that's you alone, sky high in the airwaves, a grand, eternal music that will always play inside you. You hear it through this golden gaze, surging ever onward, drowning out the crackle of the flames of the oil rigs at night on Arab desert sands miles underneath you. Far above Elia and myself, giant powers feel a fold of time and matter soften round us, aching out a passage like they haven't felt before. They push and fill this passage out with cosmic enormity, then spin us in an arc that is greater than a galaxy, but smaller than an atom, with an ecstasy beyond physicality, beyond mind or thought or the bars of time and matter. Here, beyond consciousness, we let these powers resonate, through my eyes and through her voice, and down through the stadium. The sky has grown to fill the screen. Each of the golden grain symbols of my irises is bossed with a perfect central black sun in exquisite radiance of heavenly geometry. My lashes curl as long as constellations. My eyebrows sweep across the sky's northern hemisphere in thin, black, sleekly tapered arcs. Eyes and lips of a flame girl dissipating into air. And telescoped within the blinding grandeur of this face and voice, the turning of the Earth's nights and days shines divine through the vastness of space, while the years and aeons unpeel, billions of tons of rock and atmosphere on water, on an orbit that is breakneck but luminously slow. The glance of the sun across the surface of the planet, through the whirl of its dawn around the volume of its sphere, lights the points of its peaks and the spumes of its waves in the tiniest of details, in a sidelight that defies any labeling of color. From the screen in the stadium, a flood of purple flame spreads, a fountain of unearthly colors, tastes, sounds, scents, and ecstatic touch pours out from screens around the world, and the oceans rise a fraction. My face fades to black on screen. Elia's voice fades out, and sound and vision glides to the smoothest of halts.
Do pick up a copy of The Imagination Thief. It's this wonderful, layered, sensual, surreal picture on picture on wave of glorious imagery.